Once again, hello to everyone. On today's BioTremor Talks, I will present what I've been working on for the last 10 years. I will speak about vibrational dueting and signal production in Aphrodis Makarovi leafhoppers. Aphrodis Makarovi leafhoppers are hemipterans belonging to Cicadellidae family, and they recently emerged as one of the new model species in studies of vibrational communication and in studies of selection on vibrational communication systems. And what makes them good model organisms is that they're representatives of a large family with more than 20,000 species, and they're common, relatively big, and their sexual communication is exclusively based on reciprocal exchange of vibrational signals between the male and the female. So just a quick overview of what their communication looks like. Males move from plant to plant where they emit advertisement calls. Advertisement call is a complex signal with a stereotyped structure, and it can be divided into several structurally different sections named ME0, ME1, ME2, and ME3. And when there's a virgin female in the range of advertisement call, she replies. And you can see that the reply is very simple. So it's just a series of repeated single pulses, and it normally starts before male call ends. And during her replies and shortly afterwards, male searches for her. Leafhoppers face many challenges to find their mate in a very, very complex environment. They need to deal with physical properties of the plants. Plants usually act as a low-pass filters. There's a problem with standing waves, resonance, but nevertheless, leafhopper signals have to spread around, and their sensory system has to be able to perceive those signals from the environment full of noise. And not only is their potential partner receiving their signals, there are also predators, parasites, and rivals around waiting for their chance. And as you can imagine, advertising yourself in such an environment is energetically demanding and even dangerous. Males, however, may increase their reproductive success by adopting alternative behavioral tactics to reduce metabolic and direct costs. I hope I showed you why Aphrodis Makarovi leafhoppers are such ideal organisms to study male and female investments in finding a mate. So, much of my research is based on behavioral experiments, and this is how the most basic experimental arena looks like. So freshly cut plant shoot and the leafhopper at the top, one or two mini shakers used for playing pre-recorded male and or female signals, laser vibrometer to register emitted and played signals, and of course, a video camera. So during our experiments, we noticed that the length of the male call and the length of the female reply varied, as did the structure of the male call. So we decided to check if and how this affects males and females. And because every Aphrodis Makarovi duet starts with an advertisement call, females don't emit their signals on their own. Let's start with male calls. REML showed after we had tested females with male cores with different last part durations, with different lengths of MF3 parts of the signals, that only 12% of variability in female reply could be explained by male ME3 duration. On the other hand, as much as 62% could be explained by the female identity. The structure of male call changes with age, as you can see here from the example shown. And analysis on preliminary data showed that male's age and structure of the call together with female's age affect the response of females. It affects whether they will reply or not, and it affects the length of the female reply. However, I won't go into further details now, since this was done on the preliminary data. Female reply. Female reply is very, very important, since males cannot locate quiet females. And for sure, female reply shouldn't be delayed. In gray, there's either median or mean together with 95% confidence interval for the normal timing of the reply. And as you can see, males had problems with recognition of the reply and consequently localization when the female reply was delayed. It's also crucial that female reply exceeds male call. So you can see that when female reply ended before the end of the male call, that's here in blue, they acted as if they wouldn't receive any reply at all. That's here in white. And that response of males was very much different when they got visible reply. And that's here in gray. In addition, the length of female reply itself is also very important. Very short and long replies cause problems to searching males, as you can see from the comparison to normal situation in black. Another interesting fact is that males started overlapping long replies with so-called masking signals. Male calling rate is also affected by the length of female replies. The longer the reply, the lower the calling rate. But what really stands out is cumulative signaling duration. At average replies only, the cumulative signaling duration is equal for both males and females. And when the replies are long, cumulative signaling duration is greater for females and vice versa. So short replies mean greater cumulative signaling duration for males. And after all, also environmental factors affect male localization. Here is the temperature profile on a summer day at different positions in the same location. And you can see that differences in temperature can be substantial. And yes, temperature is another factor that affects mate recognition and localization. Females respond less to males from different temperatures, and less males localize female from different temperature. And if you remember, This slide, vibrational communication is never a private communication. It always occurs in a group of several animals within signaling and receiving range of each other. And we were particularly interested in rival interactions. And apparently, females just don't care about females competitors as they didn't change their behavior. On the other hand, when males were faced with a dueting rival, they immediately tried to take advantage of him. They start searching before they start calling. They were emitting less advertisement calls, and some of them didn't emit any call at all. And besides that, some males that were exposed to a male-female duet, they were emitting, more of those males were emitting masking signals. But most importantly, males exploiting the other male in a duet were as successful in locating the females as if they were dueting with those females. So not calling and emission of masking signals to hide female replies is not male's usual behavior, which means that whenever possible, males switch to alternative behavioral tactics. And when we tried two males and a female in a simple networking environment, we got that males that made it with the females, that means winners from the contest, had shorter searching time. They were first to locate the female, and once again, they were better at exploiting replies to the other male. Winners were also in better physical condition, and winners also received less replies overlapped with masking signals. Females, on the other hand, were replying to both males equally, and they made it with the first male to come, even if male didn't emit any call at all. You can see here, and those males that were not emitting advertisement calls are pure satellite males. And that's just a jackpot for males in terms of costs. Energy consumption correlates with respiration rate. And as you can see, respiration rate for males is 2 times higher at signaling than when they're moving, and as much as 10 times higher than at rest. And when we compare males and females, we see that resting respiration rate is higher in females, but when it comes to emission of vibrational signals, respiration rate is higher in males. The effort they put into vibrational signaling is not negligible. So higher signaling activity leads to a shorter lifespan both in males and females. What lies behind such an energetically demanding activity? Back in 1949, Ossian Nilsson described in Aphrodis Bitsynctus females striated thimble, and in males complex convex integument together with muscles and their attachments. And under SEM, we found exactly what he was writing about a convex integument in males and a striated thimble with 9 mediolateral furrows in females. The largest thimble muscle, Ose Nielsen named it dorsoventral muscle 1 from the first abdominal segment, so DVM1, attaches just beneath the thimble. The black arrows indicates the thimble, and let's see. Just to tell you, in orange is DVM1, so dorsoventral muscle 1, the main thimble muscle, and the red structure is its attachment. See? Attachments of DVM1 are just where the thimble is. And on muscle segmentation, we see that male's muscles are much, much bigger compared to females. For instance, volume of a pair of DVM1 muscles in males is approximately 40 microliters, while in females, only 6. Moreover, males' myofibrils are approximately 1 micrometer thick, and they're thicker compared to females. And myofibrils comprise around 50% of the muscle volume. There are also numerous trocheoli and mitochondria with a very, very dense matrix and plenty of cristae. And there's also a lot of smooth endoplasmic reticulum. And all this suggests that DVM1 is a fast muscle. In males, compared to females, there's also a greater mitochondria surface area, and along with the greater muscle volume, higher respiration rate during the emission of advertisement calls and masking signals might be explained. So we have a huge, powerful DVM muscle attached directly beneath the thimble. So how does the thimble move? These here are high-speed camera recordings of thimble movements together with simultaneous recording with the laser vibrometer from the ground where animals were standing, both in males and females. And red arrows here indicate thimbles. What you will see is that left and right thimbles act synchronously, and every move of thimbles is associated with a pulse in the signal. So let's see how it looks in males. And the same thing in females. Movements of the thimbles and pulses on the surface. So how the vibrational signal is then produced? We inserted two measuring electrodes into the leaf hopper, as you can see here in this video. So the thimbles were still moving freely. And another reference electrode somewhere in the abdomen. And at the same time, we were recording signals with reservoir vibrometer from the ground where animal was attached. And here are the examples of recorded EMGs in a male and a female. And you can see that EMG appear simultaneously on the left and right electrode, meaning that both DVM muscles contract synchronously. So one contraction means one movement of both timbal membranes and one pulse in the signal. Vibration on the ground was detected approximately 8 milliseconds after EMG, which might be due to the latency in muscle contraction and transfer to the ground. And how and if DVM2 and DVM3 or any other muscle contributes, it's just impossible to say from this experiment. They might, I don't know, regulate the stiffness of the timbal. They may be involved in the contraction or tension of the abdomen. And the answer to this, however, would be given by the synchrotron, which is the goal in the future. So thank you very much for joining us at BioTremo Talks. And of course, I would also like to thank to all that anyhow contributed to my research.